Good afternoon, folks. Thanks for everyone for joining us today. We are getting started momentarily. We'll probably get started a few minutes after the hour. We usually have some folks joining on shortly after the hour starts. And one of our presenters is running, will be joining us a little bit later. I think she's just joining on now. If you haven't already, please do add yourself to the agenda notes. There's a link in there for this specific meeting, and you can add yourself in the attendance list. Once I stop sharing this sort of introduction slide there that has the link on there, I will turn the presentation window over to our presenters, our guests today, Seth Anderson and Jessica Meyerson, who will do our main presentation. And then we're going to have a little update from the storage working group, after which we will talk more about our planning for 2019 and what we want to do that year in terms of as a working group. We started this conversation at DigiPros conference last month. Just sort of continuing the planning there, picking out some more topics, settling on sort of a format. There's a question about maybe switching that up a little bit, and we'll get to that towards the end. So I'm going to wait a couple more minutes, I think, before we get started to see if we get some more people joining on. And then I'm going to stop presenting this sort of welcome slide here and turn things over to our presenters today. Seth Anderson, Program Manager at Yale for the Emulation-as-a-Service Infrastructure Program, and Jessica Meyerson from Software Preservation Network, Program Manager there. Thanks, everyone.
All right. Hello. Can you all hear me?
Yep.
Great. Okay. Sorry. Okay. And I can't. Okay. Let me just get set up here with my slides. Where is it? Nope. Wrong window. Just a sec. I have too many windows, which is a common problem. Can you see, Jessica, what are we seeing right now?
I can definitely see your Google Prezo tab. It looks good. So once you press present, it should be good.
All right. There we go. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Yes, my name is Seth Anderson. I am the Software Preservation Program Manager at the Yale University Library in the Digital Preservation Services Department. And Jessica and I are here today to talk about a current program of work that we are collaborating on, technically called Scaling Software Preservation and Emulation Services. But for short, we like to refer to it as EaaSI, which stands for Emulation as a Service Infrastructure. And I'm going to give an overview of what we're up to and what we plan to do. And then Jessica is going to take over and give a quick overview of how we're engaging a community to help us think through our approach to this work. And then she's also going to talk about some of the work the Software Preservation Network is doing in this area of emulation and software preservation. So I will dive right in and just start with a broader question of what exactly is emulation as a service?
Excuse me, Seth?
Yep.
When you clicked on present, must have gone to a different screen because we're still seeing the original slides in edit mode.
That makes sense. Great. Let me see what happens. Do this and share. How's that?
Yes, much better.
For some reason, the little halo is not popping up around what window I'm showing, but no, there we go. Okay. Emulation as a service. Some of you may be aware of this platform under a different name. For a long time, it was referred to as BWFLA. And it began its life as a research project conducted at the University of Freiburg by a group of developers there who were looking to sort of scale emulation so that it was a bit easier to use and more user-friendly so that it could be applied in many different disciplines for different uses. And to give an example, I guess, of how it actually works, I'll just simply demonstrate that to you with our current version of the application, which means I have to switch screens. And I get to the right one. Okay. So you should be seeing a sort of white and gray interface, user interface, with the little easy logo in the corner. Please pipe in if that's not what you're seeing. So essentially, this software platform is a web-based application that uses a central API to manage workflows related to launching emulators and configuring emulated computer environments. And what it allows me to do as a user is eliminate many of the technical skills required to run emulation software. But it also simplifies just the decision-making process for configuring legacy computer systems. So to give you an idea of this, if I start with my objects, so in the system we refer to digital collection materials as objects. So that could be something as simple as a group of files that you want to access. That could also be a disk image of a CD-ROM. Or a data set. These are the things that are in your archival collections or libraries that you want to use the system to access. So we currently have one example in here, which is actually just a Microsoft Word doc from, I think, the mid-90s. And what we don't have right now, or at least in this example, would be a suitable computer environment within the system to access it. So what I would do is go to my available environments. So I have here a number of computer systems, which are simply operating systems that have been configured in an emulator and saved so that I could use them for what I'm doing now. So we have a number of Linux operating systems in here. And then we have a Windows 98 base operating system environment here. So just given knowing what I know about this file, this is the operating system that I would be looking for. And since it's a Word doc, I need to add Microsoft Word to this environment so that I can access that file. So again, knowing what I know that we've already loaded a version of Microsoft Office 97 into the system. And when I tell the interface that I want to access that operating environment, system environment, and use that software application, it simply retrieves the computer environment, launches it in the emulator, and attaches the installation disk for Microsoft Office 97 into a drive on this emulated computer. And so then I, as a user, can go through and install this software. Hopefully this key works. That's correct. Right. And of course, these things take time. So I will treat this like a demonstration on a cooking show and stop the environment. And so let's assume that I went through and I saved that that emulation environment that I just added Microsoft Office to and saved it. I could then find it in the system. So we have here Windows 98 second edition with Microsoft Office 97 installed. If I add that to my list of environments I can use to run this or access this digital object, I then run it. And so now what the system is doing, it's taking that revision of the original Windows 98 environment I've created, pulling that together into the emulator, and then mounting the digital file that I want to access in that emulated environment. And so if I open that, which gets mounted as a disk, I can now access that Word file. If it opens, it should take some time. And then we get fun things like Clippy, who shows up here, to get in the way of us doing what we actually want to do with the file. And then I could save this object environment so that the system would retain this connection between that software environment with Microsoft Office installed and this object so that I could access it again in the future. So if I click, whoops, save environment, it's gonna ask me to name this. I gotta give a description. All right. And so now my object environment here is saved and available to access whenever I need it in the future. So just gonna check the chat to make sure there's not any questions about this. Okay. Now I gotta figure out how to get back to my presentation. Okay, are we back to the slides?
Yes.
Okay, great. So to get to this point has taken a number of years. And as you may have noticed, the system functions rather well, but it is not the most, it still has not been sort of, you know, optimized for a good or user-friendly experience for non-experts. So starting in January of this year, the team here at Yale, which includes myself and a number of representatives from outside the university, including original developers who have created the system that I just showed off to you, but also includes Jessica and others involved in other aspects of software preservation. But we started this project with the goal of addressing a few different challenges. So one, The emulation service and other emulation services still don't scale to meet the needs of a broader spectrum of users. So we've seen the tool implemented in a number of sort of one-off or small-scale installations. It is open source, so you could deploy it yourself and use it in your own institution. But again, that's not a very user-friendly process, and it still requires a lot of technical expertise and hand-holding from the developers to get that system up and running effectively. Second challenge was that, of course, I've only shown a demonstration of one application installation or one set of applications installed, but there are, of course, thousands of potential applications that could be used in an emulation environment or in various emulation environments. And it really, in the minds of, in our minds, shouldn't be the responsibility of one institution or, each institution using this system to acquire and install and configure these applications for themselves. Third, I didn't get a chance to show, the details that we have on the materials that are in the system, but they are rather lightweight. And this is mainly due to a lack of comprehensive or standardization around the descriptive practices in the sort of computer science domain. So it makes discovery difficult for users, but also there are a lot of operations or functionality that we think we could automate or enhance based on the descriptions of the environments and software that we incorporate into the system, and we cannot do that just yet. And then finally, what I was demonstrating to you, which the current version of the emulation as a service platform is really intended as sort of a back-end or administrative system and not something that would be opened to, say, the public or end users of any kind. So the way the system is designed, you can take the environments you create and incorporate them in some kind of access platform. But again, because the system has not been widely adopted or implemented, these types of services are either limited in scale. Yale is currently working on one for a specific collection at the university, or they're non-existent. So there's really has been little illustration of how a system like this could support end user access moving forward. So that's where the EaaSI project comes along. As I mentioned, it started in January of 2018 and runs through June of 2020. And in response to those challenges, we are working on expanding and improving the infrastructure of the system to achieve four primary goals. The first is to implement a distributed management model. Instead of having a number of siloed implementations of the system and having each institution or group that oversees that instance manage their own service or use of the application, we're looking to pool institutional resources and sort of just general brain power to develop services that support a broader network of emulation as a service users. So part of that distributed network model incorporates actual system functionality, wherein members of what we call the EaaSI network, their instances of the emulation services can communicate with each other and use resources at other locations. So this is, a very, what I'm sure many of you are familiar with as far as distributed network models, but just as a simple visual representation. So if we have two institutions, one that has a piece of software and one with a computer environment, like say that Windows 98 environment I was showing earlier, and the second institution wants to use, let's say it's Microsoft Office 97, just to stick with the example I had before that this other institution has, they can simply retrieve that software on the fly from the other institution, run it in an emulator, and save that software environment. So they now have a saved instance of the installed Microsoft Office 97 at their institution. And likewise, the institution here on my left could look at that software environment and say, oh, I like what you did there, and now I don't have to do that configuration step, and simply just copy or run that software environment on the fly for their own purposes. So in this way, there is an exchange of resources between these two institutions, but also all of the institutions entering into the network, so that we have a growing pool of software and environments available to everyone who uses the service. And part of that goal within the project that Yale has committed to, we have a collection of thousands of software, image software installation media, and we plan to seed the network collection with those applications, but also we will, in early 2019, have students begin the work to create pre-configured software environments. We'll be installing software into emulated computer environments and providing those back to the network for other institutions to use in their own workflows. Right, and then the third goal, of course, is to focus on discovery and generally description of computer in the computer science domain. So looking at how we describe software applications and computer environments, and figuring out how we can utilize that information within the system. We're also incorporating services developed by the Wikidata for Digital Preservation project, which was started by Kat Thornton, who is part of our project team, which is building descriptive tools to aid users in contributing metadata into the Wikidata knowledge base. So we're looking at using Wikidata as sort of a central registry for our software metadata. And so we'll be incorporating some functionality to allow users to catalog and describe their software applications through our interface and have that information pushed into Wikidata. But we're also pulling information out of Wikidata to use in discovery workflows and in providing more information through our interface. And finally, Yale, as part of this program of work, has committed to creating prototypes for a number of different access services or platforms. We're still working out what the details of all of these will be, but essentially the four we've committed to are a service for sharing emulated CD-ROM environments between institutions who can show that they have a physical copy of a CD. So if Yale has already created an existing CD-ROM object environment, and another institution can show that they've purchased a copy of that CD at some point, instead of them having to go through the process of disk imaging that CD and setting up the emulator, we can simply provide them a copy of that emulated CD-ROM environment, and they can provide access to that moving forward. Also looking at functionality around managing virtual reading rooms for special collections materials, working on a scientific software portal that provides unique functionality and descriptive purposes for configuring and operating emulated environments for research reproducibility and access to legacy data sets. And then finally, currently working on the concept for an API service that automates selection and rendering of selection of computer environments for submitted digital objects. So if you give a file to this API, the system will analyze it, determine what computer environment would best provide access to that file. So if you give us I'll use a Word file from the mid-90s, for example, it would determine that, say, Microsoft Office 97 is the best software for that, find the environment that has that software installed, and return a link to that environment to the submitting user, wherein the file is already rendered and available for access. So there's a lot of technical bits that go with that, but we're hopefully going to work through that by the end of the grant. And I think I'm about on time, but it's time to turn it over to Jessica, who's going to talk about some of our participatory design work. And then we will wrap it up from there. All right. So I'm going to stop sharing and...
Okay, everyone. Can you all see this?
Yep, we're in your edit mode. Launching a presentation.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So let me skip ahead because it went back to the top. So y'all forgive me real quick. And all the folks that are watching this as a recording, just forgive us while we get back to our drop-off point. Okay, perfect. Thank you so much, Seth. So as if that wasn't a lot of really interesting information to think about and map back to your own institutional context, I have a few pieces of context that I will add to some of the description that Seth just described about the scope of the EaaSI project. And then I'll also make an attempt in the 10 minutes we have before we jump into questions to telescope out a little bit and look at where EaaSI is positioned in sort of the broader context of the efforts of the Software Preservation Network and the software preservation community at large. So within the EaaSI project, I just want to re-emphasize Seth's point about distributed management as a core component, sort of like a first principle or philosophical underpinning of how we're thinking about the project, which is that whole no single institution can do this by themselves. And so how do we facilitate that both technologically, but before we can even facilitate that technologically, we have some capacity building to do within institutions because this is still not sort of mainstream digital curation practice. And so the way that we're doing that with our partners, who nothing would be possible without our partners, based on this core premise, of doing this collaboratively or kind of not at all in a sense because of the scale of the problem, is to walk through this series of participatory design and research activities. And so the nodes in our network at this time are 5. So we have the University of California, and I'll introduce them again on a different slide, but the University of California, San Diego, Stanford University, Notre Dame University, University of Virginia, and Carnegie Mellon University. So these are founding nodes in the network and are absolute partners. They've been fantastic. They've sort of helped us to iterate not only in our understanding of what our development roadmap and sort of where some of our priorities can be reprioritized to address their most kind of pressing needs in implementing this institutionally, but also thinking about how to iterate over these instruments, the kinds of questions that we're asking of our internal stakeholders in order to get everybody on board and really start to think about how this applies to different user constituencies on campuses or within other organizational contexts. So again, like why approach it this way? Well, this process of going through these questions together, that this sort of reflexive process, but also doing some work to actually gather up the data that we already have. So like, let's start from what we already know and what we're already doing and work from that place. And so we want to build ownership over the project outcomes as a whole, We definitely want to boost confidence, again, grounding in the work that everyone is already doing, right, at various stages into various implementations. But, you know, people have thought about this long and hard. Everyone is working in different roles to make that same goal of sort of digital curation and preservation happen. So let's start there. Definitely setting expectations kind of about the scope of resource investment when it not only comes to things like compute hours and storage, but staff time and resources, which are really mounting to kind of be the bulk of the investment so far, and probably most likely on an ongoing basis. And then fostering community engagement, again, right, like getting everyone to think and make part of their identity or a facet of their identity about being a member of this particular network and of the software preservation community at large. And overall, all of these factors, like 1 through 4, help to ultimately reduce the risk of failure for these kinds of community-based or consortial efforts, and consequently costs. So not just in terms of dollars, but just in terms, again, of like human investment in this effort. So who is participating? Again, we mentioned all of our founding nodes in the network, and we're so grateful to be able to just draw on their collective expertise, many of whom have been involved for decades at this point in distributed infrastructure projects of various kinds, including distributed digital preservation networks. And then our advisors so far, where we're sort of trying to put together a group that represents perspectives that are not currently in the active pilot node group, but that we can totally see the network expanding to either in a subsequent round of a subsequent call for additional nodes in the network within this grant funded round, or looking ahead to a future funding proposal where we would ask to expand the network along particular axes, such as national borders. So what does it look like to have international members in this pilot network, and what are the issues that we're going to have, or the barriers that we're going to have to overcome for that? And then also, what about consortial members, right? So one of the other basic premises that the group has talked about from the very beginning is that we know that all of the institutions and organizations that we're working with have some system, some form of digital infrastructure, some way that they're approaching digital curation in their organization already, right? And they continue to iterate over that and build it and improve it. But instead of thinking about this as like a wholly separate kind of appliance, or thinking about this as kind of sitting on the side and being a separate thing that needed to be managed, we wanted to acknowledge, and which we did through a series of stakeholder interviews at the very beginning, which I'll talk about a little bit, to establish what everyone already had in place. You know, what's your authentication protocol for your organization? Many of which said shibboleth, and then that fed directly into team conversations about where to prioritize that kind of authentication development work with each of the nodes in the network. And just saying what we want to do is make sure that we're building on top of what everyone already has in place and looking for all the points of abstraction that we possibly can to make it easier for more and more people to incorporate the use of this network or service on top of what they're already doing. And so for that, we have the BitCurator Consortium, the Texas Digital Library. So these are, BitCurator Consortium is a digital forensics consortium of practitioners that uses the free and open source software BitCurator Linux operating system, which has packaged with it many digital forensics open source software tools and some GUIs to facilitate those digital forensics workflows and digital preservation triage. We've got TDL, again, Texas Digital Library, which is a distributed digital preservation network. The CFA is the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. So we also wanted to make sure that if we only had one or none of the nodes in our pilot network that were really focused on that scientific reproducibility research software use case, that we had some voices and perspectives that were lending their expertise and experience to what we were doing, because we knew that one, as Seth mentioned, that is one of the promised sort of proof of concept access portals, But additionally, we really are thinking about this across domain, right? This is underlying infrastructure. So in terms of the access reuse cases, I should say, that it can accommodate, it should be pretty wide in its breadth. And we also have internationally looking at the Digital Preservation Coalition is one of our advisors. And William Kilbride has been on one of those calls. So just getting perspectives from, you know, European and beyond, beyond Europe and also beyond the US, members of the digital preservation community that might be interested in this. So what are the issues that are specific to them around GDPR and around like network latency or whatever it happens to be in terms of like where these different servers are located and how that changes our view on exchanges of information between members of the network. We have the University of Toronto in Canada. And we have the Open Preservation Foundation. And we will probably look to very intentionally expand the group of advisors, again, to incorporate additional perspectives that aren't already represented here, not only for the duration of the project, but looking beyond as well. So again, our methods here, we structured interviews, some inventories that we've asked everyone to do, looking at the distance between scenarios for use and access that the representatives from each of the nodes they felt were likely to drive interest in software preservation and emulation in their local context, and then providing an instrument that they could use to survey some of their user constituencies to look at that distance between, you know, what they feel are those driving use cases, and then what their users in different parts of campus or their organizations are telling them about what they think is going to drive their interest in emulation in their own work. Looking at baseline cost measurements way upstream, I mean, way up front. So we attempted to use the calculator even in this pre-implementation phase, just to start to get a handle on what is sort of the staff time investment required to do these capacity building exercises, because we want to make sure everyone is on the same page and that that onboarding process becomes more streamlined. And as we progress into the implementation and testing phase in sort of the January, February, March timeframe of 2019, people will begin, you know, each of the nodes, including Yale, will begin to fill out the cost calculator, and we will check this probably like every few months when it sort of makes sense. Maybe we do a big upgrade or the nodes expand the number of users beyond staff users to some sample users in different departments on campus. And then we can start to take a look at those numbers and how they're shifting over time as usage increases. And then if there is, which there will be eventually, some sort of fee structure or business model for the network and associated services, that is empirically grounded in what all of the experiences of the pilot nodes were. And I think that we are also looking to these future items, which, you know, we can expand on, but I think maybe we'll follow up with Nathan to not only provide this slide deck, but also maybe to elaborate a little bit on some of these. And I just want to make one point before we hand it off to Q&A, because I know we're short on time. And again, if anyone has any questions about this, I think you should just contact Seth and I. We would be more than happy to talk about any of these things. I really just want to focus on one thing in sort of the zooming out part of it, which is the shared measurement piece. And looking at sort of these different areas of the SPIN platform and to put the affiliated projects in that context, which is to say that these exercises that we just walked through with you all, listing out kind of those onboarding pieces, we're doing those same research activities with the FCOP group. The Code of Best Practices for Fair Use and Software Preservation, I will just endorse and encourage you all to read. It is up on the ARL website at this moment. And you'll hear more about it. There will be a webinar in the spring that takes a deep dive into the five scenarios described there. On the legal front, I'll also mention as a related initiative that we received the 1201 exemption to break technological protection measures on software in order to preserve it and software-dependent objects, which is fantastic and is due in large part to the Cyber Law Clinic at Harvard University, particularly Kendra Albert, who is our legal counsel there, as well as Brandon Butler at UVA, who's involved in the ARLBP. So I'll just say that that shared measurement across those 11 different institutions involved in both of those projects is what is helping to inform the broader strategic goals and priorities of the Software Preservation Network. And so all of these things are related, sort of interdependencies, as it were, that we are hoping will help to drive and inform and reinforce the activities of one another. And so with that, I'll hand it off to the group with any questions.
Could I just also pipe in? This is Seth again. None of this work would be possible on the EaaSI project without the generous funding of our sponsors, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation and the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. And we're getting to that. There they are. So we're very thankful to their support for this work. All right, now Q&As. Or maybe we were thorough enough that we've left nothing to question.
Well, thank you both, Jessica and Seth, for the presentation. I've sort of been from afar, seen some conference presentations and a bit about the Emulation as a Service project, and haven't yet quite seen much since it's taken on this new life, since this new project started in January. So this is really interesting to hear the direction it's taken. This is really exciting work to hear about. I would be interested to hear, and this probably fits very well with some of the recent work that you just described with the ARL, the best practices for software preservation, and the exception that was just granted for DCMA, which is awesome news. But when you were talking about, you know, the environments and the applications that are loaded into those environments, you know, Windows 97 and Windows 98 and Microsoft Word 97, could you talk a bit about the rights situation? You know, if we have the installed disks, or, you know, or do we, does that presuppose that you have the rights to have those environments, or are we leveraging fair use to be able to use these environments, or how does this work in the shared distributed repository of environments for institutions to share across?
I can take an initial stab at that, and then I'm going to hand it over to Seth, and maybe Seth, you can shed some light on the MOU work, because those are the same kind of questions we're trying to address through that participation agreement, so to speak. But one thing I'll say is that scenario four, to get pretty specific, for the Code of Best Practices for Fair Use and Software Preservation, really does get at exactly what we're trying to accomplish here as a cultural stewardship community. So in terms of the EaaSI project. So this idea of, you know, I have procured, I'm at Institution X, I'm at the University of Texas at Austin at the Briscoe Center for American History. And I'm the digital archivist there. And I have procured through some means, whether it was purchase on eBay, whether it came through as collection material, or whether I sent a call out to the IT talk list to ask anyone in their various IT departments if they have any 3.5-inch installation disks that I can use for the purpose of accessing existing digital collection material. And I've procured those things, I've imaged them. As it gets a little bit older with optical media and sort of licensed servers that you have to ping with those authentication numbers and things like that, they do get more complicated. So I'll just say with that, the distribution model does problematize certain like idealized forms of these workflows, which we can talk about in more detail in a different forum. But I will just say that we are relying heavily on a belt and suspenders approach, at least in the United States. Right now, right? Which is, we're lucky because we have these user rights approaches through fair use in 1201 that other countries with our colleagues that are doing similar work simply do not have. They don't have these existing legal mechanisms. And so through those tools, that is the basis upon which we are moving forward with this work. And so I would encourage you all again to sort of review the scenarios, which are 1 through 4, kind of walk through a workflow almost from like acquisition and triage to documentation of an environment or a particular software title to reading room access only to how do we sort of respond to reading room access in a virtualized and network environment, which is what we're sort of characterizing EaaSI as. So that would be my briefest response, Nathan. And then Seth, I don't know if you want to mention the emulator.
Yeah, so we are, as Jessica mentioned, leaning heavily on the guidance of those ARL best practices, but also as part of the rollout of the sort of EaaSI network service, wherein all the different institutions will be pooling their software and environments together. We're working on an MOU or a participation agreement, which sort of establishes that understanding in a mutual agreement between all parties involved, but also outlines certain operational requirements for each institution to assess and understand what they are doing with those materials, which are in many cases sort of commercial applications. And trying to ensure that no one is submitting things that would be, are known to be problematic, or would jeopardy, put those who are using it in jeopardy in any way. So we hope that, yes, fair use will be helpful in this regard. That is to say that, the examples I used were primarily commercial applications and operating systems. We are also looking, of course, to support open source and free software applications with the system as well, which would hopefully, in many cases, be a bit of a lower threshold to reach when it comes to the associated legal restrictions.
Thank you. I know that's sort of a big question.
It's a tough one to answer.
Yeah.
And I'll just reiterate that there are a lot of, like, an awesome group. Everyone should be excited because we're lucky enough to have a growing community of legal scholar practitioners that really understand what we're trying to accomplish as a community in terms of software preservation. And that includes Brandon Butler at University of Virginia, Krista Cox at ARL, Kendra Albert at the Cyber Law Clinic, Chris Babbitts at the Cyber Law Clinic, Patricia Ofterheide, who's actually head of communications at American University, but studies the development of cultural norms and helped to establish the methodology for fair use, for the code of fair use, and has done that with other communities of practice, such as documentary filmmakers and dance archives, with Peter Yazzie at American University. And then we have a couple of colleagues in the UK that helped to join the conversation about legal and policy issues related to software preservation during the webinar series in March. So I would encourage you all to check that out. That's Andrew Charlesworth and Burkhart Schaefer. Really interesting, and we're still looking to expand that particular, sort of group of, or that perspective, that source of expertise within this software preservation ongoing activity. So yeah, more to come on that. And if you have specific questions, highly encourage you all to send them our way. We would be happy to fill them in more detail.
We are starting to run short on time, but were there any more questions from the members on the call today?
So yes, hi, this is Kevin McCarthy from the National Archives. The question I have is, have you guys given any thought to utilizing cloud resources to help in, say, management or scaling or even the cost aspects of this program?
Yeah, so The actual infrastructure for the service is decentralized. So each institution can install the software on whatever infrastructure they wish to use. So some of the groups that we've already engaged with are planning to use cloud infrastructure to deploy the service. And so that includes both, you know, the compute required to run, but also storage to, you know, manage the data in the system. So we're looking at how to optimize the infrastructure for this first release to make sure that it operates effectively in the cloud. And then part of the program of work as well is to look at how we might sort of encapsulate it as just an appliance that you can purchase in the cloud instead of having to, you know, manage it and install the software on your own. So we're definitely interested in ways of improving on the service and making it as easy as possible to deploy, whether that's, you know, upgrading the installation process so that it's just like a simple configuration that you have to set up, or looking at turning it into more of an appliance that you can just purchase from the cloud or retrieve from the cloud.
It's also worth mentioning with those baseline cost measures, to your point, at least two of the founding nodes in the network will be deploying their easy node in cloud infrastructure. So in terms of having cost measures associated with that as compared to local hosting infrastructure and compute hours, we will have some basis for comparison there.
So before we let you guys get to your next agenda, I'll just really quickly point out some timeline milestones. So we are releasing a beta release of the system to that first round of node partners in early March. So they'll be doing rollout of that through the first half of the year. And then we do plan on creating some kind of public facing prototype of the system that will allow users to interact with free and open source software as a means of demonstrating and having a sandbox available to other interested parties. And then we're also looking to recruit more institutions to join the network. And that will probably, that process will start in the middle of 2019. So we'll put out a call for interested parties. And then we'll go through the sort of standardized rollout process with them and hope to schedule deployment for fall of 2019 or early 2020. So that by the end of this program of work, we should have anywhere from 10 to 15 institutions operating as part of the network.
All right, thank you very much. Again, both to Seth and Jessica for the presentation, for the excellent work on this project. We have 8 minutes left. I think both Jessica and Seth will probably be willing to take questions via email. And if there's anyone else who didn't get an opportunity to ask a question, there is a link to the slide deck on the notes and then document here as well. And I believe I have contact information for both of them as well. And I see Seth is at, both emails are in the chat as well. Laura, are you available on the call to give a brief update on the storage working group?
Yes, I'm here. So as most of you know, we've formed a working group recently to take on the next iteration of the storage infrastructure survey, which has not been run since 2013, so it's about time. We have a great group of people that I'm trying to schedule our first meeting for before the end of the year. So if you are still interested in joining, shoot me an email. We'll still take anybody who wants to join. But that being said, I think we're in a really good place to get this project off the ground. So thank you to everybody who's already volunteered.
All right, thank you, Laura. The last item we have on the agenda today was to do with our planning for 2019. Linked on the agenda is a document where we have some proposed topics that we came up with at the NDSA working lunch. There's sort of a column there. Facilitators, just sort of looking, and we don't really have a whole lot of time necessarily to dig into this. Maybe we can continue this on our next call. Would be looking for folks to maybe contribute additional topics if there were different ones that people wanted to look into. If anyone was interested in facilitating or there was a topic here that you knew you would want to lead. And facilitating those would be, as we've done this year, would just sort of be organizing the main speaker or a group of speakers on a one particular call on that month. Has anyone had a chance to look at these, or was there anything that anyone wanted to add to the list of topics, or did anyone have any strong opinions one way or the other about something that's on here? I kind of like the suggestion that I believe it was Carol had at the working lunch, Carol Pissman, to have sort of, instead of doing every month, having a topical call with some business at the end, of maybe having two topical calls and then an unscheduled meeting, to leave some space sort of in an unscheduled way there for people to bring up whatever sort of issues they might be facing from an infrastructure standpoint, just to have some space there for general issues. And I thought that was a really good idea. I'm wondering how people felt about that, as opposed to just doing, you know, 12 topics. If we cut back, you know, to do 9 topics and had sort of three unscheduled calls to see what emerged. Okay, well, I'm sensing no strong feelings in one way or the other. Why don't we call it a day then? Feel free to make comments on any of the Google Docs or our notes or to send an email if that's you feel more comfortable doing that as well. Otherwise, thank you for joining the call today. Hope everyone has a happy Thanksgiving and safe travels if you are traveling to be with anyone. Otherwise, thanks and have a great rest of your day. Cheers, everyone.